Okay, well, thank you. Hello everyone. My name is Gerrit van Aken. I'm from Würzburg, which is in northern Bavaria, about 200 kilometers from here. We have a small agency, which is called Whitespace GmbH, which is a pretty cool name, I think. And we also have the domain whitespace.gmbh, which is very cool top-level domain. Which is not so cool is that we don't have any women on the team. So diversity is not so good. If you are a woman and you love the web, you might give us a call. No, seriously, it's not cool that we are four boys and we want to change that in the future. So what we do web applications and websites, mostly for the car sharing business. We do car sharing booking websites and so on. So we're not specializing or not focusing on typography that much, but typography was always my special kind of toy topic. So in the last 15 years, I'm caring about good typography on the web. And yes, that's the book I written in 2012. It's a little bit outdated now, but you still can read it online if you like webtypobuch.de. It's free for downloading, I think, and if you want the printed copy, which I would not recommend, you can order it here for $20 or so. This is not this is a very old. This is a new book that I would recommend to you. If I have one recommendation today, then it's Web Typography by Richard Rutter, which came out last year, which is a much better wrap-up about the whole web typography thing. You should get this book and read it very carefully. It's very, very good, and it's in English, of course. I was here in 2010 on the first WebFont day, and I did three theses. I looked that up. A thesis is the plural of thesis. There were three sentences that I formed. The first one being web fonts can be worth the effort, especially at higher font sizes. So it was indeed not that clear that we really could use web fonts at this time. We specialized on the headline sizes. In the body text size, where we had 12 pixels at the standard back then, it was quite tricky because not every font was optimized for 12-pixel display. So today, 16 pixel is more like the new 12 pixel in the body text size. I know somebody has read the article, the essay by Oliver Reichenstein, which was called 200% Easy to Read Standard, where he said we should all make 16 pixels the new default body font text size, which was crazy at that time. 16 pixels, this is huge. Nowadays, 16 pixel is perfectly normal for body text, and when we have a modern screen like the Retina screens or high-resolution screens, then it's doubled. So mostly we have today 32 pixels in body text size, which is perfectly okay for using web fonts. You can see all the small details of your font and the characteristics of the glyphs. So pretty much normal now. The second thesis, retrofitting traditionally designed websites using web fonts, rather unpleasing. That's not so important because not a single client asked us to change his websites and turned the normal fonts to web fonts. That was simply not the case, so we can skip that. The third thesis, though, is quite interesting. Web fonts require a new web design paradigm, and the other way around, the new web design paradigm requires web fonts. This was true at that time. In 2010, the web design, the layout paradigm was changing a little bit. We had really great, really huge headlines. We had hero-sized text, hero boxes, large type all over the place. And if you set those large hero texts in, say, Times New Roman or Verdana, it just looks shitty. So we had to use web fonts to make this really big headlines attractive, and that was a you needed both. You need to know a new web design paradigm, and we needed web fonts to fulfill a more creative and more expressive web design feeling. So back to now, part two of my presentation, web fonts in 2018. winners and losers. So the last 8 years since the last Web Font Day, or the last 10 years of web fonts in general, there's a story of winners and losers. We have some techniques, some things that are winners, some are losers. I start with the biggest winner of all. I might be Google Fonts. Google Fonts is really everywhere. If Eric Spiekermann was here, he would say it's like water. It's like superfluous. It's every website. There are more websites that have Google Fonts included than website without web fonts at all. So it's the new standard, the new default, and it's like the WebSafe fonts from the 90s. Anybody remember? Maybe. I think let's do it. We had Times New Roman, we had Arial, Verdana, Georgia, Trebuchet, Comic Saw, yes, Courier, and Impact. This one is often forgotten. So we had 8 fonts. With Google Fonts now we have 900 families of fonts, which is huge. But it doesn't make it 900 times better. Because the quality of Google Fonts is mixed, to say the least. There are some really good families, of course. We have OpenSaw, we have SourceSaw, we have Lato, we have Roboto, of course, and we have really, really good families, but there's a lot of crap out there on Google Fonts, and a lot of plagiarism. Some fonts that look familiar, but you can't quite put your finger on it, and so you think, okay, it might be a rip-off, but you can't really prove it. So it's a little bit, if you choose Google Font, you might choose wisely if you don't want to have quality that is not satisfying, and it needs a profession to choose wisely from the huge amount of fonts here. And of course, we have some kind of monoculture as well, as you see OpenSaw everywhere, because it's the most popular font from Google Fonts, and it's quite the new Arial a little bit, and it's not so creative just to use OpenSaw over and over again. It looks good, but it looks a little bit boring with the time. But the good thing about Google Fonts is, or was, they have superior external hosting. It's so easy to include a Google Font in your website. They host the fonts for you. It's one line of code. You put it in and you have a beautiful font. So that was the most successful factor. It's free, it's easy, and has a very good external hosting. So let's talk a little bit about external or local versus local hosting. I have the possibility to do a to embed the font from a foreign server, from Google Fonts or from Typekit or from Typotake, or you can just have the font on your own web server where the rest of the your website is located, just like images or JavaScript files. Which one is better? Not so clear. At the beginning, 8 years ago, it seemed inevitable to have those fonts externally hosted, because web fonts are, it's complicated to have all these formats, and the licensing is quite, the most fonts are not available for downloading and hosting ourselves. We thought that we just had to use external hosting for several years, but it's not like this anymore. Locally hosted fonts are perfectly normal today. It's the new standard. Almost every font is available for self-hosting, and I would recommend this model too for reasons that are still to come. Because Google and Adobe are possibly evil. You know, Google is not the nicest company anymore that they were maybe 8 years ago, and Adobe, you all know it. I'm not sure what they do today with their Typekit business. They changed it, the name, they changed the website. It's not so clear what's happening with existing users. So it's a little bit in a limbo right now with Adobe and fonts, I'm not sure. The trust is a little bit gone. Indie foundries, on the other hand, are possibly unreliable. If I have a small foundry which offers its own hosting service, maybe like Typotake, so I'm not quite sure if they are existing anymore in 1 or 2 years, or if they have their servers up and running all the time. So the hosting is a delicate issue, so maybe it's good to do it on your own. Plus, we have the data privacy problem. You all know the GDPR, or in German, the DSGVO. In May 2018, we went through all our clients' websites and looked for externally embedded fonts and made them local. So that was quite a bit of work, but I thought it was necessary to clean up all the external shit. So we have not too much to notice in the data privacy statement. So in May 2018, we kicked all the external Google fonts and made them local. We tried to buy fonts for self-hosting where we had Typekit in use, and it worked out quite good. So that was necessary. That was a refresh a little bit. You should do that maybe too. Okay, next topic. I should get some water. Okay, talking about web font performance. It's a big topic under web designers. The easiest way to make performance good is subsetting to gain a smaller font file size. There are three methods for subsetting your font files. First of all, by language. This is the easiest one. It's a no-brainer. If you have a website which is only in German or in English, you don't have to include Cyrillic characters or even Arabic characters or something like that. You go by language. Second one, you can strip out open type features you don't need. If you don't use small caps, then you don't need to include them in your font. And the third one is a little bit special, by page content. It's possible to have a specialized web font only for a specific page. And I only include all the letters I need for that page. And so you can have a really, really small font file size. But it's a little bit unpractical because, if I have to have a custom file for every single page, I can't cache it anymore. And maybe it's for special cases by page content. Then, of course, you can use a content delivery network. If you have externally hosted, then it's included. If you have to do it on your own, a content delivery network is not so easy to have, and it's rather unusual just to have a little bit faster delivery of your font files. And, of course, you can use advanced loading strategies, which is a heavy topic. There's an excellent article about advanced loading strategies by if you're crazy enough, I can show you this. This is from Zach Leatherman, his most popular article, Comprehensive Web Fonts. It's about loading strategies where you can gain the last milliseconds of performance of your font loading. It's very complicated, so you see it. I won't go through this. We have a certain techniques where you let's say you have a website with six styles of a font and you want a very good perceived performance, you should load the regular one, the regular body text style, at the very first beginning of the website loading, so that there's something to see in the right font. And then you load all the images and all the JavaScript stuff, and at the end of the file you load the other styles, the bold and the italics, so that you have a perceived performance which is very good, but you split up the loading of your fonts in two pieces, and it's complicated, and I'm not sure if it's needed. Because let's say we have a typical German newspaper website. This is Zeit Online, Zeit.de, in my opinion, one of the best looking German websites, newspaper websites. They use two web fonts in two styles each. They have two styles of tablet Gothic in WoW 2 format, and they have two styles of Franziska Web as WoW 2. Franziska, is Jakob Runge here? No, he's not here. Yes, guter Mann, yeah. Franziska Web, beautiful font. And these four styles together, they have 144 kilobytes and four server requests. only on the first web page load, then it's cached by the browser. So it's not that much. If you compare it to 1 megabyte and 150 requests for image data, and 1.6 megabyte and 89% requests for JavaScript. That is if you have ad blocking deactivated. So we have a lot of performance killers out there with image and JavaScript, so that the font is not that big topic. Yeah? The image data is different on every site, on every page, so maybe the fonts are not really the problem here, and we shouldn't, maybe, we shouldn't not put too much time into web font optimization, because there are other construction sites where you might have a better effect on your time. That's my giveaway for you. So, next up, the flash of invisible text, FOID, and the flash of unstyled text, the FOID. I'm not sure how to pronounce this. We all know this. If we have a website on our mobile phone and we are in Edge land, we are in a slow connection, then the website will load, but the fonts are not there yet. Sometimes the underlines are there and background images, background colors are there, but the font itself is invisible for maybe 2 seconds, 5 seconds, maybe 2 minutes if we are really, really slower. And that's really ugly, and that is the old behavior. In newer browsers, we see a lot like this, the flash of unstyled text. The text shows right away, but in a fallback font here in Helvetica and Georgia for 2 or 3 or 5 seconds. When the correct web font is loaded, then it swaps, and it swaps to the correct web font that we want to see. So this is the more modern version which most browsers prefer nowadays. So you can start right away. The web font, the website load, and you can start reading. It's the false font, but that's okay. You can start reading. So, the good thing about this is we can control this behavior with font display, which is a pretty new CSS property. It's not in all browsers yet, but will be in the near future. So, when you say font display auto, then we have standard behavior. It's not interesting, but we can say font display block, which simulates or forces the flash of invisible text behavior. If you like this. As a web designer, we can say swap. This forces the flash of unstyled text behavior. And we can use fallback, which is a little bit like the swap property, the swap value, but with a give up behavior. So it's like you open the web page, there is the fallback font, you read it, and if maybe 10 seconds or 20 seconds have passed, it would be uncool to then swap the font, because the reader has already gotten used to the font, and if you're halfway through the article, then the swapping comes, it's not so nice. So it gives up, and only on the next page that's loaded, it will show the correct font. And we have one value which is optional, which I didn't understand. It's so complicated, I just wrote it down, what is in a... it has to do with timing, and I didn't get it. So maybe not so important. But we can control this now. And the question, which is better, would I like to have invisible text or unstyled text, is a little bit up to the topic of your, or the context of your website. And I say it's a little bit about branding versus usability. If you are keen on having your branding intact, so that only correct fonts are displayed, then you should strive for the invisible text and wait for the correct web font. If you want the reader to start right away reading, and it should be clean and easy and fast, then you should strive for the unstyled text. And if you want to raise the usability. And okay, we have a room full of designers here. Maybe you are more familiar with the invisible text. But if you are usability savvy, you might choose the right one, the usability one, the flash of unstyled text one. That's what we do. We always want the reader to start reading as quickly as possible. Okay, we can make this really quickly. How many styles should I use? Less is always better, but not for technical reasons, more for stylistic reasons. We all know if we have a design with 8 styles of a font, it might not look that good. Technically, it's okay if you have 8 styles included as a web font. As we seen earlier, it's a little bit of kilobytes, not megabytes. You can do this, but it looks doesn't look good. So maybe less styles for better visual experience. Okay, a little bit of history. Previously on web font technology, 8 years ago, we needed to have our fonts in 4 different formats. We had the beautiful embedded open type for Internet Explorer. We had, of course, the classical true type with no encryption or no security. We had the SVG font format, which I'd never heard of before, but it was necessary for Android version 4.1 or something like that. And we had the WAF format still. It's from 2011, I think, the first. I'm not quite sure. But we had to have them all 4 formats, if we wanted to be compatible to IE6, which is now not the case anymore. We have more like this today. If we want to support Internet Explorer 9, we only need the WAF file format and the WAF2 file format. And if we can ditch Internet Explorer altogether, we have Edge, Microsoft Edge as the new standard, then we only need the WAF2 format, which is very nice. So this is getting sane with the formats, and clearly WAF wins as the font format. That is a true true winner story, I could say. A new font format made up by the community somehow. It's really, really good from supporting. So what should I do when I'm a client and I want to license a font? First of all, what clients hate. Clients hate, okay, they hate to pay for fonts at all. That's clear. But if you can get them to pay for fonts, they do not like to buy the fonts on their own. But they must, because the agency is not the licensee. The website owner is the licensee of the font, and you have to bring them to license the font with their credit card and their credential, which is pretty hard, but you have to do it. Clients hate to subscribe to a rental system in general. They don't like recurring costs. They like one-time pricing, and that's the case. So rental system is not so easy. And of course, clients hate to integrate tracking pixels. They don't want to the foundry to know the amount of success with a website and so on. We had that earlier with data privacy and Google. Ideally, if we all can check on that, maybe another thesis of mine, comfortable licensing might be more important than the actual quality of the typeface. So we had a case where we decided against a certain typeface because the licensing was not okay. This might be in the future. You have to, if you are a font maker, a foundry, you have to offer a good license, a simple license, that your font will be used as a web font. The winning price model is the so-called single pay page views trust based. So a little bit complicated, but what does it mean? You have to pay once. You have to pay an amount depending on the amount of page views that you will have, that you project to have with your website project. And it's not controlled by a tracking pixel. It's self-hosted, and it's by trust. You say, I license it for 500,000 page views a month, and then I get the license. I have to pay once. And if I exceed this 500,000 page views, I have to buy a new license. So most clients understand this. This is easy. Most vendors offer it, fortunately. Sometimes the definition of per website is a bit vague. Some vendors make it per domain, some per website, and that's the question, what is a website? Do subdomains count in? it's not so clear in each case what a website is, but maybe you can figure that out. And of course, yeah, growing page views. If the page views are getting more and more, the clients have to buy a new license. But in the reality, I'm not sure how often this really, really happens, that a website which is growing buys a new license for the success of their website. I'm not sure if this really happens a lot. Okay. My advice for you as a client or as an agency, of course, buy from the foundry, directly from the font maker, which is the best way. If they have a decent online store, if they have a easy way to buy the fonts, I cannot go to my client and say, oh, buy this beautiful font, but you have to write an email to the font maker and then they make a special offer for you and then you have to give them your credit card number or have a, it's complicated. You have a decent online store, and if you don't have a decent online store from the foundry, you should go to FontSpring and search there if the font is available there, because FontSpring is, in my opinion, the best experience for buying fonts. I guess they have some decent agreements with the font makers, and the best function from FontSpring is this little button, get card permalink. It's really, really cool, because as an agency, you can log in there, you can prepare, you can choose the fonts, you can say, I would like this style, this style, this style, I have this amount of page views a month, and then get this permalink, send it to my client, he clicks on it and does the checkout process with his credit card. So there's no room for mistakes. The client gets the correct fonts, he pays with his name and his organization, he is the licensee, so that is really, really handy. Okay, I hope we have 5 minutes left for some little case studies very, very quickly. This is a website we made 2 years ago where we used the font Alvin, and it's still delivered by Typekit, because this is one rare case where we didn't get an offer for the font to buy, so we use Typekit. This is the Typekit from the client itself, and we use some nice, you can see it here, some nice small caps. So it looks nice. It's very easy to include OpenType features. It's just one line of code in here, CSS code, font feature settings, SMCP for small caps, one. And we use, on some other pages, we use tabular numbers or table numbers too. So it's absolutely no problem. It's a no-brainer. If you want to use OpenType features and they are included in your font, you should just use it per CSS. It's very easy. Second example is an example of a failed license. We wanted to include Sansa as a type for this web page. It's a flight simulator software. But the Sansa family, done by Type Tailors, was formerly distributed by Our Type. And they don't like each other anymore. So there was a time where you couldn't license the Sansa. Instead of writing an email to Type Tailors and asking, and I wouldn't do that. So we made this later and said, okay, maybe later we will license the Sansa font. For now, we chose a somewhat similar Google font, but that's not perfect. So if you have a font out there, make sure that the licensing is really easy. Next up, we have Scouter, which did an interesting thing. Scouter is a client of us, a car sharing client. The corporate design said, please use Castledown as a font, Castledown by Colophone Foundry. And they have some really strange things in their license, because they ask you to do an addition to your HDXS file, where your server is affected. They ask you to, for security reasons, they ask you to put some things in your HDXS file to secure the font. But what they do is they deactivate font caching. So the font files are not cached anymore and are loaded on each page load as a security measure. But I didn't understand why they do this, and it wasn't really, really good for the performance of the website. So I didn't include that bit and I hope it's okay. I hope it's nobody is here from Colophon. But it's technically it's nonsense to force your clients to deactivate the font caching via the HDXS, which is it's nonsense. So we had this font; it's beautiful. We like it very much, but we embedded it our own way. We paid for it, though. One problem with this page, this is a security expert and the web page from Mark Semler. He wanted it a very, very performant website, very, very clean, very, very small, very, very quick. And the font we should use was Brandon Printed. And Brandon Printed is very problematic for web font usage because it's such a dirty font with those stencil effects in it. Yeah, and it's really, really huge because a lot of dots in it, a lot of lines and splines in there. So it would be like 2 or 3 megabytes per style, and we couldn't afford that. It was too much for our very clean, very fast websites. So we decided to fake it. We used Brandon Grotesque as a clean font, not the dirty one, and made a texture which we put it in the background of the font, which is really, really hacky. It doesn't look that good, of course. It's not the original, it's not that pretty, but I think it looks okay, and it's much smaller in the performance-wise. So it's a little bit tricky from the CSS here, a little bit complicated, but you see what we did here. We had background clip and web text fill color and some crazy magic there. I looked that up on Stack Overflow. It works, it looks okay, and it's very much, very smaller than the original font. One last example, Computer Base. It's a Windows gaming magazine for gaming hardware, and they have some really crazy users. They have almost all Windows users, and some of them don't like font smoothing. So they not only deactivated ClearType on their machines, they deactivated font smoothing at all. So they are users, they have still 1-bit monochrome pixelated font, and we wanted to use Fira as a web font, and it's very problematic. So on the left side you see the Mac version, very, very nice, Fira Sans here always also in the body text. But here we have the Windows version, which looks a little bit different. It's okay. You can see it's quite okay. But in the body text, we switch to Arial, because Arial is the font that looks best on 14 pixels when you have no font smoothing at all. You can see it like this. This was the problem. If you have no font smoothing, Fira looks like shit. And so we decided we can't get there. We can't force the Fira people to make a monochrome hinting for one website. So we've done that. We ditched it. And if the browser detects, oh, I'm on the Windows machine, then we use just Arial for the body text. Okay, almost finished. I have two roundups for my little talk. The first one is slightly sarcastic. Make it quick. Most websites use web fonts now. That is no question. Most of these use Google fonts, as I said earlier. It's like water. Most of these use OpenSaw. And that says something about fighting typographic monoculture. So it's a little bit, einheitlich, as we in Germany sagen. It's monotone. It's we have these possibilities, but we don't use them. If we look into a brighter future, on a lighter note, we might say almost all browsers support web fonts now. The screen resolutions are getting higher and higher. Look at Retina screens. Open type features are ready to use. No problem there. And licensing and pricing is fair or even free. That is the most important part. That was absolutely not clear 8 years ago, that the pricing and the licensing would be so easy that it's in most cases today. So there are less technical barriers than ever to make creative websites. And I guess we should finally start to make use of these possibilities that we have now. There is so much potential that is unused today. So I hope that today we will see some ideas about how to make creative use of that. And on this light note, I would say thank you. And yeah.